Yeah, wonderful. Thank you very much for inviting me. So my name is Markus Höhne. I'm working at the University of Leipzig in Eastern Germany as a social anthropologist. And I'm occupied with Somali affairs, let's say, since around 2000, so almost 20 years, I would say. I started writing my master thesis at the University of Munich on, Somali peace and conflict issues. I went the first time to northern Somalia in 2002, like on a preliminary visit, preparing my PhD proposal. And then from 2003 onwards, I did like a 1.5 years field research as a social anthropologist in northern Somalia until end of 2004. Then I wrote my thesis, and ever since 2008, I have been visiting northern Somalia regularly, like once or twice a year in different capacities as researcher, as consultant, even as a guide for tourists recently in the last couple of years. So in different capacities, I've been around in northern Somalia like over the past 15 years regularly. And yeah, so I have been in Mogadishu once or twice, briefly as a consultant, but just due to security conditions, it's not the place where you can do field research. Yeah, so that's basically my background. I also have conducted a study together with students from the University of Leipzig and a colleague from the Max Planck Institute for Social Anthropology in Halle. I have conducted a study on the lives of Somalis in Germany, on which I will draw also in this presentation. And the study has not yet been published, so we are just in the process of, going through the text, through the draft, and, turning it into a book. So yeah. Anyway, I think that's pretty much it from my side, and I would get started. It's a bit unusual for me because normally I would see those people with to whom I'm speaking. I don't see any of you. If you don't hear me, or if my kind of internet connection hang up or something like that, just please give me a sign. Otherwise, I will now start my presentation.
Yeah, in case of anything, we will also give you a sign.
Okay, good. Great that I can hear
All
you. Yeah,
right.
that's nice. Okay, so let's get going. Though it's about return to Somalia. I mean, before we speak, I mean, about return to Somalia, I would, of course, give you extensively some background about the situation in Somalia. Following the questions which have been put to me by the organizers of this seminar or webinar. So these are the points I'm dealing with in my presentation: the living conditions, reasons to leave, expectations Somali migrants have when they start a migration to Europe, experiences on the way, also then Somali lives in Europe, but my focus will be on Germany mainly, but also some scarce information I have from other places in Europe. And then how Somali migrants in Europe represent their lives, towards their family or friends back home in Somalia. And finally, I will deal with the question of onward or return migration. So living conditions in Somalia. So Somali Peninsula, as you can see on this web on this map, the Somali inhabited territories on this peninsula involve much more than just the territory of the Republic of Somalia. So due to colonial partition, Somalis have been spread over four nation states today, inhabiting parts of Djibouti, eastern Ethiopia, northeast Kenya, and of course Somalia. The Somali population in the Horn of Africa roughly is, I mean, there's no real, how do you say, reliable estimate, I mean, reliable numbers, but the estimations would be something around 12, 13 million Somalis living in the Horn of Africa. And then additionally, maybe 1 million Somalis spread over the globe. So it's difficult to really come up with concrete, with exact numbers, but there would be something like 12, 13, 14 million Somalis living globally. And of course, the vast majority in the Horn of Africa, as you can see. The environment there, I mean, this whole area, which is kind of a little bit darker on this map, this whole area is semi-arid, or it's kind of a semi-desert area, except some, I don't know, do you see my mouse, my arrow here?
Not yet.
Oh, okay, so maybe I have to use this one if I like.
Oh, no,
So
yeah.
So now you see it. Also the only, so to say, permanent water sources are in this area. There's two permanent rivers, Chabelle, which runs around here, and Juba, which runs around there. Though between in this area you have more permanent water sources, and you have also more fertile land, which is used for agricultural economic developments. But in much of, you know, much of Somalia, though, this whole territory, including eastern Ethiopia and Djibouti, of course, it's pretty much desert land. Sorry, one second. It's a clan-based society. I don't know who of you is familiar with Somali ethnography, so to say, but it's one of the famous examples of being a clan-based society. I will talk about this in more detail when it also comes to the relevance for migration and security. It's Somalis are, to the vast majority, Sunni Muslims. I mean, I never met a Somali who said he was not a Sunni Muslim. Actually, there's very few people who would say they would be atheists, or they would have been converted to Christianity, mostly in the diaspora. But actually, it's a strong Sunni Muslim country, and Somalis are very proud Muslims. So the infrastructure of the territory is very limited. So there's very limited tarmac roads. There's a few urban centers, like one would be here in Hargeisa. Then you would hear Berbera, Bosaso, Galkayo, Mogadishu, Kismayo, and Baidoa. So this would be like the six largest towns of Somalia. And in the last, let's say, two decades, you had a rapid urbanization. So Mogadishu would have by now probably something like 2 million inhabitants. Hargeisa, the second largest town of Somalia, would probably have something like 1 million inhabitants. So there is strong urbanization, but still, I mean, I would say that probably like still 50% of the Somali population live somewhere in the countryside, and this is very sparsely inhabited land. I mean, it's a huge territory with just a few people living across the space. And now let me briefly talk about the relevance of, you know, this word clan-based society. What you can see on this graph is a very very much simplified outline of Somali patrilineal genealogy. So this is just in the father's line. And you can see a couple of group names here. Like if we start from the bottom, you would see a clan called Warsengeli, Bulbahante, Machirten. There are many more, actually, but they are rather small. These are the rather well known. They belong together at a medium level of segmentation to a forefather called Harti. Then on a very high level of segmentation, all these people belonging to these different groupings belong to Tudarot. And then at a rather legendary level of descent, they would be all Samale. You can see Samale involves many, many groupings and subgroupings, and they would go on here over generations, so to say, to the living persons today. And then there's another big division, so to say, in the Somali society, which is called Saab, and they are mostly like Rahnwen groups belonging to them. But I mean, the interesting thing maybe for us is that Somalis living today, many Somalis living today would be able to count their ancestors in the father's line from, let's say, Ego. So my name, let's say I'm Ahmed, my father is Yusuf, my grandfather is Abdisalam. They would count in the father's line the names up to probably Warsengeli or Dulbahante, and then first on to Harti. I mean, there's lots of ancestors in between, let's say Machirten and Harti, so there's more generations in between here, and then there's more generations in between here, so they would count 20 to 30 ancestors in order to identify themselves in this kind of patrilineal kinship network, if you like. So this is a way of positioning yourself in Somali society. But it's not just about, and this is like the prime, the these kind of relations in the father's line, they are the primary relations of solidarity, if you like. So if I have any kind of security problem, if I feel threatened by somebody, I would call my cousin, my brothers and cousins on the father's side for support, and there would be a strong moral obligation that, you know, my extended patrilineal family would support me and defend me against any kind of threat or problem. But besides, so to say, what was commonly called clan in Somali, there are of course also the ties on the mother's side. So each woman in Somali society, of course, has her own clan, her own father's family, so to say. And since Somalis very often marry across groups, so to say, though, if I'm belonging to Durba Hunter, I probably would marry a girl from Warsengeli, or a Habercello guy would probably marry an Ogaden girl or something like that. So there's, so to say, a Somali individual has the primary solidarity relationships to the patrilineal relatives, but he or she also has, of course, ties to her mother's family, which we call on the slides the matrilateral ties. And then, of course, if I marry, anyone marrying, I would again establish relationship to my in-laws' family. So these are kind of the three basic orientation points for many Somalis: patrilineal descent, matrilateral ties, and affinal ties. And together, these kinship ties provide a matrix for solidarity and assistance, also for moral obligations and responsibilities. So if I make it, like if I have an individual career, I'm obliged to give back to my close relatives, first of all my own clan relatives, but of course if I want to have good relations to my in-laws, I also would support my in-laws and so on and so forth. So there's responsibilities, and there is of course also assistance and help in these networks. And the interesting thing from a point of migration is that this of course is not place bound. So it works in Somalia, it works in Kenya, in Ethiopia, it works everywhere, wherever Somalis live. It works of course also in Denmark or Germany. So these ties are transnational, provide for transnational networks of assistance and also obligations. And the most well-known and relevant obligations, of course, also in the context of migration, are financial remittances. So I guess many of you have heard of this concept that Somali migrants, of course not only Somalis, but in this case, Somali migrants who made it to Europe or North America are very often obliged to send money back to their families in Somalia or also in Kenya. Many have also relatives in Kenyan refugee camps, so then the money flows from Germany or Denmark to Kenya or to somewhere in Somalia. And also these remittances are, you know, organized in this kind of kinship networks. There's no official banking system anywhere in Somalia, but of course the money is still transferred in a kind of semi-legal or illicit space. There have been a couple of official Somali banks registered in Europe and North America, like the Habshil or Amal or Kah or so, but in the context of anti-money laundering and terror financing laws in the last couple of years, many of these banks have been shut down again, or it became really complicated to use them. So there's now currently, as I'm aware of, there's currently some quite clandestine way of transferring this money, but it's constantly flowing, and this remittances sent back from the diaspora to the Horn of Africa, they support lots of things back in Somalia or back in Kenya, like the schooling of smaller siblings, healthcare for the parents or for any kind of other relatives, housing, water, and so on and so forth. So it's actually vital. These remittances are absolutely vital for survival in Somalia. So let me talk briefly about the different political realities where people are coming from. And Somalia is not just Somalia. I mean, what we hear since like 1990, in the last 30 years, basically from Somalia, mostly comes from Mogadishu, from this area, the capital city, also a little bit of Kismayo, and then probably Baidoa. Baidoa. The map is relatively small. So Baidoa, Mogadishu, and Kismayo, this is kind of the area in southern Somalia where since 1990 the civil war reigns, and which is producing most of the horrible news we are receiving in Europe from Somalia. And this is ongoing. I mean, this is also the, this is still the territory here in these areas where Al-Shabaab has a strong presence. I mean, they have been kicked out from Mogadishu, Kismayo, and Baidoa since 2012, around 2012. But as of today, Al-Shabaab has a strong presence in this area, very close to Kismayo, around Mogadishu, Afgoye, also in the surroundings of Baidoa, and in this whole area bordering Somalia and Kenya. So this is where Al-Shabaab is still very strong. So this is the most insecure area of Somalia, and this has been so over the last 30 years. This is insecure for foreigners, but it's also very insecure for many Somalis, and particularly for those who return from the diaspora. So then you have central Somalia, which has been an area where Al-Shabaab has been operating 2007 to 2012, let's say. But in the last 8 years, I would say it's mostly an area where you have clan militias again, kind of, you know, like the former warlord structures, which also developed here in the 90s. They are still present here, but it's kind of, you know, it's more clan militias and it's, you know, warlords who have been kind of integrated into the Somali government, but still they follow their own clan-driven agenda, if you like. Then you have an area here which is called Puntland in northeast Somalia, which has been declared as an autonomous area in 1998, so since more than 20 years. You have Puntland with the capital city of Garowe here, and which is a major port of Bosaso, which is kind of an economic hub, which is rather stable. I mean, more stable definitively than south and central Somalia. It is occasionally infiltrated in this area by Al-Shabaab. And then from 2008 to 2013, you had piracy problems in this area here. So this was, but this was very much localized. But the bulk of Puntland is stable for the locals, let's say. It's relatively secure for the locals. Al-Shabaab has a very small presence in this area. They kind of formed a little kind of dependency there west of Bosaso exactly, which affects security in Bosaso, but mostly for, you know, for government officials or for foreigners. But Al-Shabaab in this area doesn't have the capacity to terrorize locals. And just for the sake of completeness, in this area, ISIS has a little offshoot. They also, but it's we're just talking about 200 fighters or so. I mean, they kind of rather isolated in this area. But it's a little bit tricky to move around in this area. Then we have Somaliland in northwestern Somalia, which technically speaking would cover this whole area. This is a former British protectorate. This territory has been colonized by Italy until 1960. So this is Somaliland. This is by far the most stable and secure part of former Somalia, if you like. It has been declared independent in 1991. However, its independence has never been recognized by any other state. So it's like an unrecognized state, which makes it pretty much a de facto state, pretty much like Thailand, northern Cyprus, south Ossetia, and so on and so on, if you like Palestine or so. So it's kind of, Somaliland is functioning in many regards like a state. It has even its own government, its own currency. It, you know, there's a series of democratic elections which have been held since 2002. So it's in many regards stable and established. However, it lacks international recognition and politically is kind of tied to the rest of Somalia, which of course is a problem. And this kind of this area here in eastern Somaliland, this is contested between Puntland and Somaliland. So in this area, you have occasional military confrontations between the army of Puntland and Somaliland. These confrontations do usually not result in many killed people or injured people, but they result in displacement, and they simply make this whole area extremely marginalized and volatile. So there's a strong lack of development in this area, and lots of social problems in this area, whereas this area between Hargeisa, Berbera and Bro is actually really flourishing. So you could arrive by plane from Addis Abeba to Hargeisa and you would believe you're in a kind of really established in Horn of Africa capital city. It's a beautiful place to be. You also can arrive in Garowe and believe pretty much the same. Garowe has developed tremendously over the last 10 years, I would say. with lots of new buildings, lots of new infrastructure, businesses opening, and so on and so forth. So this kind of is a positive, there are positive developments, but this area is pretty much still kind of in a limbo. So it really depends where people are coming from. So if people come from this area, they have experienced a very different reality than if people came from this area. However, Somali migrants in Europe come from all over the place. I mean, they do not only just come from Mogadishu or Kismayo, but they also come from Hargeisa, Bor'o or Garowe. And of course, some of them then kind of change their biographies on the way. Because if you come from Hargeisa to Europe and you say, I have been persecuted by Al-Shabaab, it's simply not possible, actually, because Al-Shabaab doesn't operate in this area. So, further to the background, that's an image, a picture I took in 2003. I mean, this is kind of looks maybe a little bit like from pre-colonial times. I don't know, but it looks maybe from a like picture book about the beauty of the country and the culture. In any way, I put it in here because it tells you something about the reality, the backgrounds of some of those migrants coming to Europe. I mean, this has been taken in 2003. You see, it's a rural area. There is no tarmac roads anywhere. It's very sparsely inhabited. The nomadic hut, which you can see, has been produced manually by the Somali women of the house. The child, which stands in front of the hut, is taking care of his smaller brothers and sisters, many of whom are still in the hut. The parents are gone with the animals, with goats and sheep and the camels. The parents and the older siblings. So this girl is maybe 12 years, maybe 11 years. She's alone responsible for the cookings and intruders. This degree of independence and also responsibility, which many younger Somali people learn early on when they grow up in the countryside, this degree of responsibility and independence is also, of course, informing some of the migrants, you know, decisions and their behavior on the way, but also when they come to Europe. I mean, not everyone comes from this kind of rural background, but still some people, particularly younger women, often come from this kind of background. And so they may have no formal education, but with 10 years, they already learned so many things about life and also about the dangers of life, which probably people like our young people will never learn in their whole life. Well, the other part of reality, of course, in the urban centers of Somalia looks more like this. So you would probably grow up in a protected space without famine, without hunger, without threats by wild animals and so on and so forth. Though this is the other part of the reality where people would come from. It has its own challenges. I will talk about these challenges when I talk about the reasons to leave. So this was basically just the first section, like what are the living conditions for many Somalis. So if you have any questions about that, I guess you will come back to in the Q&A session to your questions. I mean, just note them down. So the reasons to leave, I mean, the prime reason to leave, of course, is the ongoing violence and the dangers in Somalia. They are related to violence, criminality, corruption, repression, also by state agencies and terror by Al-Shabaab. So the image which I put in here is, of course, representing the terror by Al-Shabaab. Over the last decade, you can say, since 2009, actually, since end of 2009, Al-Shabaab has developed complex terror attacks as its hallmark. So very often it's improvised explosive devices, which they are using, stuffing, you know, small cars or even trucks with explosives and letting them explode somewhere in the city. I mean, mostly targeting government infrastructure, but also like hotels and restaurants where like diaspora Somalis mostly stay, or government officials stay, or expats stay. So the targets are involving lots of bystanders, so to say. It's not clear targets. It's not just, you know, the Ministry of whatever foreign affairs, but it's kind of a restaurant where very often, you know, government officials take their lunches. So when a bomb explodes in this restaurant, of course, many unrelated people get hurt. So that's kind of the hallmark of Al-Shabaab. So using this improvised explosive devices, also often in combination with the attack of a small group of armed Al-Shabaab fighters who are kind of first breaking the doors and shooting the security guards, and then the bomb is kind of driving in or thrown in. And then after the explosion, the fighting continues until, let's say, all Al-Shabaab fighters have been extinguished by Somali National Army or other armed security who are then rushing to the place. So it's very often, you know, involving lots of civilian victims. Regularly between 20, 30, 40 people are getting hurt. And this is characteristic for the life in Mogadishu, particularly since 2009. I mean, nobody ever has counted how many civilians have been killed in these kind of complex terror attacks, but it goes into the thousands. So, that's just one form of violence which characterizes life in Mogadishu, partly also in Baidoa and Kismayo, but the center of terror attacks of Al-Shabaab is in Mogadishu. Then, as I just said on the slide, government officials is also a relevant factor. I mean, you can imagine there has been Somali governments have been, say, selected, often with international support, often outside of the country. So there have been conferences in Addis Abeba, in Kenya, in Djibouti, all where Somali governments have been installed. So these governments have a very limited, so to say, legitimacy and limited influence in Somalia. So the last government actually has been elected or selected in Mogadishu, in the airport of Mogadishu, which is high security zone, securitized also by or secured by African Union soldiers from Burundi, Uganda, Liberia, and so on. So the African Union has a huge security or protection mission in Somalia, which is called AMISOM. And the last presidential elections was secured by AMISOM in 2017. And the government resulting from this election, which was not a free and fair election, law involving one person, one vote, but it was kind of a very indirect election, just involving a couple of thousands of Somali representatives electing a government for the country. Anyway, the result of the last elections was a government which now is residing in Mogadishu. However, it barely controls the capital city, and it has some influence in other parts of the country, mostly by Doha, also in the surroundings of Mogadishu, and to some degree in Kismayo. But the government is by far not an effective, legitimate national government. Even if it's called Somali National Government, its influence is quite limited. And as this image shows, even under its in the territory which is officially controlled by the government, Al-Shabaab can operate almost at will. And this government, of course, is threatened. It's very much under threat by Al-Shabaab. So though its measures against terrorism are extremely harsh, so regularly anti-terror units of the Somali government round up young people in Mogadishu and collectively, you know, put them into prison and torture people in order to get more information about Al-Shabaab. So that's what I mean by repression. It's very difficult to deal with the Somali security apparatus if you are a young person who is suspected of somehow, you know, not being loyal to the Somali government. There's lots of corruption. I mean, Somalia is one of the most corrupt countries on earth. If you follow the evaluations by Transparency International, there's still also lots of criminality. Many people are armed in Mogadishu, in Kismayo, in between in the countryside. I mean, Somalis very often carry some kind of semi-automatic rifles, or at least store them in their house. And of course, criminals, like everywhere in the world, use these kind of weapons. There's lots of generalized violence, also gender-based violence. I will talk about that in a minute. So these are kind of the prime reasons for people, of course, to leave. Doesn't mean that all of those people running away from violence leave to Europe. I mean, many of them are internally displaced people. Many of them, you know, try to just run away from Mogadishu and kind of reside in a refugee camp in the countryside, or they try to go to relatives in another town or even in the countryside. And many Somali refugees actually also try to just reach Kenya or Ethiopia and then stay there in one of the larger refugee camps just across the border. Another factor, which in my eyes at least is very relevant also for those people trying to move away from Somalia to Europe, is kind of the general lack of, you know, peace. So I'm not talking now about the hotspots of terrorist violence or state repression, but I'm talking about much of the country actually, where you know, you see heavy weapons are patrolled in the streets in order to kind of scare people into obedience, where the local power holders, you know, be they warlords, be they kind of officially nominated governors, or be they even traditional elders who kind of control small towns and villages in the hinterland of Somalia. I mean, in order to express their authority and their power, very often local power holders parade heavy weapons, and of course these weapons are also occasionally used. I mean, if some young people demonstrate against something, very often one of these cars with a heavy machine gun is just rushed to the area and they start shooting. Not always on people, also above the heads of people, not in order not to kill too many people, but occasionally people get killed in demonstrations and so on and so forth. And this is rather usual. I mean, this picture I took myself in 2004 in a small town in northern Somalia, and this was nothing spectacular. This was kind of just happening there. And I think it tells you something how people are exposed to kind of general threat of violence in many parts of Somalia. One of the key reasons to leave for many young people who arrive in Europe, I would say these days, is not, you know, the immediate threat of violence, also not this kind of generalized feeling of insecurity, which I just spoke about, but this kind of lack of hope. In many parts of Somalia, even in the most peaceful and stable parts of Somalia, like Somaliland. So you can see on the one side of the image I posted here, you see Gollis University, which is a private university in Hargeisa in northern Somalia, which has been established by some diaspora guys in 2000 or 2002. It's flourishing, it's offering relatively good higher education. You have to pay for it, probably something like $300 per semester, depending on what subject you're studying. So it involves a certain amount of money in order to study. But I mean, quite a few like middle class people would be able to enter this university. The tragedy is that, you know, once this university was opened in the early 2000s, the first or the second generation of graduates, most of them got jobs in the local economy, relatively well-paid jobs. But now we are running, so to say, the fifth, seventh, eighth generation of graduates in 2020. And already since 5-6 years, it's clear to most young people in this area that graduating from a local university doesn't guarantee you a job anymore, because simply the unemployment rate is so high that it's the market simply cannot absorb all these graduates anymore. So the future, even if you are middle class and even if you manage to enter university and pay for the graduation, the future is by far not secure. So you have to move on. You have to get a degree, ideally from abroad. So some people try to go to Kampala, to Nairobi, to get a master degree in an interesting subject, which then would qualify them working for an international NGO back in Somalia. But also these places have been taken by now very much. This kind of general lack of, you know, employment opportunities makes people hopeless. And then this other side of the image here, you see a middle-aged man just having this bundle of leaves in his hand, which is cut, which is a mild narcotic plant, and the leaves are chewed in the afternoon by many Somali men, simply, you know, like chewing away, you know, whatever their despair and their, you know, their unhappiness. So you chew with your friends, you get kind of cheered up a little bit, and you get a little bit high, but it's extremely unproductive. I mean, you have to pay for that, you don't work. So it's kind of a sign for the structural problems regarding employment and opportunities in Somalia for me. And many young people notice this. I mean, many young people see their older brothers and fathers and uncles chew away their lives, and they decide with 15, 16, 17, I don't want to go down this line. I rather try my luck somewhere else. And then they first maybe move to Nairobi and to Addis Abeba. And from there on, they move maybe to Khartoum, then eventually to Libya. At least this was the traditional route. And then they try to make it to Europe. So this is, and then those people, of course, who made it to Europe, then they would send messages back to their peers, why are you still in Dustland? So this is a quote I have from a report which is written by Nimo Ilhan Ali, a Somali colleague of mine, who wrote in 2016, she published a very nice little book called Going on Tahrib. I will post the cover later on. So, and another reason, which is of course rarely ever documented, is structural inequalities, between majority group members and minority group members. So, in the Somali clan system, there are people who are more privileged than others qua family belonging. So if you belong to a strong family, to a strong clan, you have lots of solidarity, you have lots of support, the chances that you make it to a moderate or even great job and get good income, which you then of course transfer within your immediate patrilineal family, these chances are much higher than if you belong to a minority group. And there are minority groups like Asharaf, Madiban, Midgan, Charea or Somali Bantu, minority groups who are structurally marginalized in Somali society up until today. So young people from these groups have much less chance to make it anywhere in Somalia than people belonging to a majority group. And then, of course, Somali women are very often structurally marginalized. So if you do not belong to a family where, let's say, your father or your male relatives very much and very consciously support you as a young woman, you are normally ending up with quite limited education. I mean, Somali women can also enter university, but the prevalence is, of course, often on Somali boys. But even if you make it to university and you get a high degree of education, then latest with 2022, you're supposed to marry. And even if your husband accepts that you would have a part-time job in some kind of office and contribute to the family income, he also will demand that you give birth to as many children as possible. At least that's kind of the rule. So with 22 latest, if you marry, you would have, one child after another over the next couple of years. So you would not be able to keep up with your job. Your education would, so to say, be just nominal, but you would not be able to put it into practice until you are grandmother, basically. So, I mean, of course, there are exceptions from this kind of path, but very often you meet even well-educated Somali women who are 25 and would have already three children. With 30, they probably have 5, 6, 7 children. And you can imagine, I mean, the first time they may have time to breathe and think about a kind of career would be again with 45, 50. If you belong to a not so privileged family, you may marry already with 16, 17, and then with 25, you already have 5 children. And that's basically it. You don't have much education and you will simply transform from a mother into a grandmother and maybe meet with your peers, female peers, and form some kind of, circles, religious circles, educating yourself a little bit and spending time together reciting the Quran, but there's not much of a career ahead of you. And generally, I mean, Somali women are supposed to be obedient to their husbands and to the male family members. So this doesn't always result in gender-based violence, but of course gender-based violence would then also be something which comes in. I mean, depending on who your husband is and how he treats you, it's domestic violence is widely spread in Somalia. And once a woman has been violated and she has not been strongly supported by her family, and this kind of rumor travels that she is kind of a single mother and she has been already violated and dishonored, then you do not have to wait for many more violators. I mean, women who are already in a weak position are very often constantly abused. So prostitution is illegal in Somalia, but there's lots of clandestine prostitution or clandestine, so to say, sex work, if you like. So single mothers who do not have much backing in their own families very often have to survive by kind of offering themselves to powerful men. And powerful men can just be policemen or whoever just has a little bit of power in the local area. So, I mean, life can be pretty tough for Somali women, particularly if they are kind of, not having backing of a strong patrilineal family, or if they kind of transgressed the moral norms once and this kind of transgression becomes public, and then they often lose their reputation, and a woman who loses her reputation is very often also isolated in her own family. This can also be a major reason for leaving, particularly of course for young women. So the expectations for young Somalis or for Somalis when they kind of start migrating is, of course, first thing, searching protection, peace and security, particularly if they come from those violent areas I just outlined. The middle class, I would say, who are also often migrating, look for education, for employment. Then, of course, family reunion is a big issue. I mean, we have a whole, you know, we have now like first, second, almost third generation of Somali migrants since the late 1980s. So family reunion, of course, is also a reason for migrating and just, you know, to get a better future, a better status, either for people who have a minority group background or for young women who want to break free from this patriarchal context. These would be major drivers for migration. So the experiences of Somali migrants on the way are quite diverse. So you would, if you go a little bit back in time, you would already have Somali migrants in the middle of the colonial period, like in the 1940s, 50s, of course. Somalis have been enlisted in the colonial armies of Great Britain, of Italy. They have been fighting in the First and the Second World War. Then in the 1950s, Somalis worked, so to say, in colonial industries on ships. So we have early diaspora communities in the UK already in Cardiff in the 1950s, where Somalis from the British Protectorate of Somaliland, which is today, you know, the non-recognized Republic of Somaliland, where they settled down in Cardiff. But this was, of course, just then you have Somali migration to the Arabic Peninsula in the 1970s with the oil boom, particularly in Saudi Arabia, where then in the late 70s and early 80s, many Somalis moved to Saudi Arabia in order to find employment on the oil fields. And then you have, so to say, forced migration related to the escalating civil war from the late 1980s onward, first from northern Somalia, where the civil war started, you know, latest 1988, and then from Mogadishu and southern Somalia from 1991 onwards, when the government finally collapsed and so to say, warlords took over and many Somalis had to run for their lives. So this was kind of the first big wave of forced migrants to Europe from Somalia in, let's say, around 1990, 1991. And then you have further waves, if you like, from 2007 onwards, when Al-Shabaab took over and started fighting, you know, for power in southern Somalia, and lots of people got killed in the fight between Al-Shabaab and Ethiopian intervention forces in Mogadishu between 2007 and 2009, and then the ongoing fight between Al-Shabaab and the Somali government up until today. So this also, of course, produces lots of forced migrants. And then, of course, you have, as I indicated above, you have this continued trickling migration of, let's say, middle class Somalis in the local context who just don't see any future in the area and who try to make it somewhere else. So depending on which wave of migrants you're talking about, those people have kind of, as a rule, different characteristics. So let's say we focus on forced migrants from 1990 onwards. I mean, initially it was often rather well-educated, well-established men and women with their children. So it was often whole families who were fleeing, or if one parent made it first to Europe, then he or she applied for family reunion and brought over his or her wife, his wife or her husband and the children. So these were often established, a little bit older people who came first, who had a real life in Somalia, who had already education and on-the-job experience, and who had a strong family base. The people who then fled later on, from after when Al-Shabaab came in from 2007 onwards, very often younger people who were kind of under threat of being forcefully drafted into Al-Shabaab, forcefully recruited. So let's say the people coming from 2007, 2008 onwards are very often young, single males or females who either do not have any family of their own already, or they only have one or two children. They so travel along with their small children, or they leave their small children with their mother or some sister, and then apply for family reunion later on. These people, as a rule, often have not so strong educational background, and they have limited on-the-job experiences. And particularly, which is maybe most relevant for, you know, say their situation in Europe, they do not have any documentation. Even if they worked as a driver, as a carrier, or in some kind of office, they very often do not have any documentation, any certificate, which would be recognized in Europe. So this makes them pretty vulnerable when they arrive in Europe and try to establish themselves. And of course, also the way how people migrate is very often different. So if you migrated in the 1970s, 80s, it was a planned migration. You got a visa, you got a flight, you came to Europe as a student, you studied in the UK, you studied in Germany, in Denmark, or somewhere else. And then maybe later on, when Somalia collapsed, you applied for asylum, but you have been already a stable person, and you had, so to say, a non-traumatic migration experience. So from 1990 onwards, migration experience of many Somalis became traumatic, related to the violence escalating in Somalia, but also related to the insecurity on the way. And let's say the Somali migrants who arrived in Europe in the last 10 years, very often, or actually as a rule, almost all of them were illegal migrants. In the Somali term, I mean, illegal doesn't really concern Somalis in this regard, but they would call it tahrib, which is an Arabic loan word. They say, please, people go on tahrib, the young people go on tahrib, which is kind of, you know, they make it without any papers out of Somalia. They have to cross over to Kenya or Ethiopia illegally, which is a challenge, but it's manageable. And then they have to move on from there, mostly through South Sudan, Libya, over the Mediterranean. And that's, of course, a very dangerous trip, and people are completely illegal, without visa, without passport. The families kind of try to support them, mostly young children, to manage and to survive this way. Of course, it's also different speeds. So people who fled like in the early 1990s, maybe with one of the last flights going out of Mogadishu, they made it within days, most likely, to Europe. And the people fleeing today, they take months, even years. And in between, they are incarcerated by human traffickers. They have to work illegally somewhere in Libya or in Sudan. They are abused, and they are often stuck for months or even years in difficult places. All this resulted, I mean, these different waves of migration resulted in what a colleague of mine called a globalized nation. So you can see on this map places where Somalis spread over the last 30 years. Of course, the biggest concentration is still in the Horn of Africa. Most Somalis just make it over to Ethiopia or Kenya and stay there as kind of legal or illegal migrants or refugees. But then, of course, there's been a route to South Africa established, and the route to North Africa and to the Mediterranean, the Arab Peninsula, North America, and so on and so forth. I mean, there's many places where Somalis would migrate to, also to Australia, Malaysia, and so on, in order to get education. In Europe, UK, and also Scandinavian countries are one of the places where Somali migrants concentrate. This is a book which I just mentioned by my colleague Nimo Ilhan Ali, Going on Tahrib. You can find it as a PDF document for free download. It's very illustrative of the problems mostly people from northern Somalia, from Somaliland and Puntland, face on their way. And you see also the different migration routes via Ethiopia to the Mediterranean, to Italy, or via Kenya across the Mediterranean to Italy. But of course, there's also alternative routes over to Yemen. I mean, before the civil war in Yemen escalated, it was a quite highly frequented route through the Arab Peninsula, through Turkey, and then over to Greece. I think you can look at this book yourself. It's a very illustrative book. This is also a very nice report, which has been published in 2016, on also the, you know, the health, mental health challenges of, you know, of flight for Somalis. I mean, traumatization in Somalia, traumatization on the way, and also how these mental health issues then play out in the new country of residence somewhere in Europe, for instance. So now let me talk briefly about Somalis in Germany and elsewhere in Europe. I think I mentioned initially, I did this study with a couple of students and a colleague from Halle, on the lives of Somalis in Germany. So I don't have too much comparative knowledge. You know, I didn't look too deeply into the Somali lives in Norway or Finland or UK or Italy. I mean, I try to kind of involve a little bit of background knowledge on these issues, but I will focus mainly on the Somali lives in Germany. Worldwide, Somalis are one of the largest groups of migrants after Afghans and Syrians. In Germany, they made it, so to say, to the top 10 of the recent arrived refugees after Eritreans, Nigerians, and people from the Balkans. I just read in a not yet published article by a colleague of mine that there's approximately 300,000 Somalis in Europe, but they are belonging to these different generations. I mean, some of them are those who arrived in the 1990s, so they are the first generation, if you like. Then some of them are the 1.5th generation, like it's the children of those first arrivals, but who have not been born in Europe, but who came there, well, like with 2, 3, 4, 5, 7 years. And then, of course, you have the second generation, if you like this terminology, people who are more or less born in Europe or born in Europe to Somali parents, and who would have most likely Danish or Norwegian or German citizenship, but they have been socialized very much into kind of a Somali family context. And they are kind of an in-between generation, if you like, when it comes to cultural orientations. The largest numbers of Somalis in Europe, I believe, can still be found in UK. Also in Italy, you have many Somalis. It's kind of due to the colonial traditions. I mean, the Somali Peninsula has been divided from around 1890 onwards. So there's still this kind of transgenerational connections to those places. And of course, also people, the older generation in southern Somalia learned Italian in university, and the older generation, I mean, grandparents' generation in northern Somalia very often learned English in order to get higher education until 1960 at least. But also in Sweden and Norway and Finland, you have huge numbers of Somalis. And I believe, like in Sweden and Finland, or probably also Norway, I think Somalis are the largest group of African migrants in those countries. In Germany, you see on this graph from the Statistisches Bundesamt, you see that the number of Somalis who have been registered in Germany increased dramatically since 2010. So there has been an increase already in the early 90s. There has been a slight decrease. I mean, many Somalis from Germany moved onward because they didn't find the conditions in Germany so beneficial for them, though for political reasons, but also for, you know, the difficulty of learning German, the difficulty of opening a business. The certificates were not recognized. I mean, Germany has its own problems when it comes to dealing with migrants. So many people moved to the Netherlands, to the UK, to Scandinavian countries. But let's say from 2010, 11 onwards, many new arrivals came to Germany. And currently we have around 40,000 registered Somalis in the country. Of course, you have to keep in mind they have different legal statuses, from having citizenship to being just geduldet, just tolerated, but without any prospect for staying in Germany for long. Asylum decisions in different European countries changed over time. In Germany, the prospect for Somalis to be recognized in Germany, at least as kind of get some kind of status, some kind of legal status, was rather bad until 2016. In August 2016, the German officials changed the evaluation of the situation in Somalia. And then for a couple of years, until I think last year, the prospects for Somali migrants in Germany were rather good. I mean, they received some kind of status, which offered them also language courses, and then after some time also options for getting education and employment. So this is kind of depending on the national evaluation of the situation back in Somalia. And then in the UK, I think that the biggest change happened in 2014 when there was a country guidance decision by an upper tribunal in London, which decided that ordinary Somalis are not under threat anymore in Mogadishu, which kind of opened the door for lots of, you know, rejections of asylum applications, and also revoking of statuses in the UK. So there have been lots of Somalis who actually were supposed to be deported since this decision in 2014. I'm not aware how many deportations actually took place. I heard in Sweden more and more deportations took place since 2018. More rejections, more deportations. So this, of course, is related to the different evaluations of the situation back in Somalia. So in the 1990s, there was no question, there was clan-related violence, there was clan cleansing, it was just a huge drama, and Somalis coming to Europe in the 1990s mostly just received asylum without further too deep investigation. Then until the early 1990s, very often still this kind of argument that per ethnic belonging or per clan belonging, people were kind of under threat, and particularly minority group members were persecuted in Somalia. This kind of still until 2005, 2006 was a strong argument for receiving asylum in many European countries. This changed around 2008, 2009. In my experience, at least, I have been writing lots of this kind of background reports in asylum cases, particularly in the UK, and they definitely changed. And then more currently, it's gender-based violence, which is relevant, the threat by Al-Shabaab, and of course, also medical reasons. So very often people who are actually now following this country guidance case in 2014, whose status has been revoked, and they are supposed to return to Somalia, they probably have developed some kind of mental health issues or some kind of general health issues, like whatever, diabetes or hepatitis or dialysis or something like that. So they now make an argument they cannot return to Somalia because the medical infrastructure is so poor that they wouldn't survive. I just skipped this one. Just if you look, of course, in Germany, that's particular, I guess, you have established communities in Western Germany and you have kind of completely newcomers, new communities of Somalis in Eastern Germany, like in places like Halle, Magdeburg, Erfurt, Dresden. So it's really interesting that the infrastructure of Somalis in Germany is quite different in Western Germany, Eastern Germany. In many places in the East, there has been not a single Somali migrant in 2003. And today you have hundreds in places like Halle, Magdeburg, Erfurt. So it's kind of a new phenomenon, of course, which comes with its own problems. Here you see just for Germany, but I think it's only interesting for some of you, how different, so to say, the number of Somalis are in certain federal states, like in Bavaria, in Hessen, in North Rhine-Westphalia. So you would have quite a few Somalis already since many years, established communities, and in other federal states like Saxony, Sachsen-Anhalt, and so on, mostly the eastern German federal states like Thuringia, and so Somalis only would have been a very recent group of migrants who are very visible, of course, in the public life. This makes them also vulnerable. So the problem Somalis are having in many European countries, not only in Germany, is that they have lack, particularly the recent arrivals, lack formal education. They have very limited formal education. They often do not have any certificates. I mean, Somalia never actually, even in the best and strongest days of Mohamed Siad Barre's government between 1969 and 1991, never Somalia issued any kind of civil registry, right? I mean, there were never birth certificate issued. There were never death certificate issues. Marriage was always and still is a matter of religious authorities, of sheikh. So the formal marriage contract is conducted by a local sheikh. It's not an official document stamped by the local government or something like that. So Somalis all over Europe, I believe, have problems with lack of documentation of, you know, the educational background, of the work background. They don't have any certificates. Then this translates rather directly in problems with the legal status. Very often the identity of Somalis is doubted. There has been, you know, extensive checks on, you know, minority group belonging. Even if people are just Somalis from Somalia or Somalis from Kenya, and so on and so forth. So all these things are put under scrutiny. And then some other problems. I mean, I'm not sure how much they are spread across Europe, but of course problems with racism in Germany. This is a big issue, particularly in Eastern Germany, where Somalis, as I just said, are like a relatively new community of hyper-visible migrants. So they're Muslim, they are dark-skinned. It means they really stick out and they really are targeted by, unluckily, by quite a few people in places like Halle or surroundings of Halle. I have lots of stories from there because I lived there for many years. And some of the stories I heard were really quite difficult to believe. So everyday racism, besides like brutal attacks, everyday racism is also just a general issue in many places. And then, of course, what I hear also from social workers and what I can see from also Somali communities, which I know a little bit better, they very often seclude themselves. So there's not so much like kind of a pan-African identity in Europe or like kind of solidarity among Muslims, Sunni Muslims, but Somalis kind of very often isolate themselves in the places where they are staying, and they build, you know, they're kind of all secluded communities. I think this at least is also true for the UK, probably also for Scandinavian countries, which then makes it rather difficult for them to interact with the majority community. And it also makes it difficult for state authorities and social workers to really kind of get into the community and offer services and provide information. So to cut this kind of issue a little bit short, you can say that Somalis are in many European countries a hyper-visible minority and are very often, you know, under pressure. So that interestingly contrasts with the status of Somali migrants in Kenya. And this is now coming to return migration. So here I have a quote by my colleague Tabia Shara in an article which he just is going to publish soon. So interestingly, there exists an opposing image of Somalis in Europe and Kenya. Sorry, I have to just...
We hope that everybody is still actively listening. Feel free to use already the chat box to add some questions you have, or like we were asking for some details about asylum decisions in your country, because I think Dr. Hühne is about to finish. I think it was very interesting. As we can see, nobody was asking questions in between. Everybody was listening. So please, Mr. Hühne, go ahead. We are looking forward to
it. Yeah, I'm about to finish this, true. So just let me finish with this quote. I mean, the interesting thing is in Europe, Somalis very often are perceived to have a rather low status. I mean, lack of education, lack of job opportunities, kind of secluded, hyper-visible minority. I mean, you do not very often, I mean, sometimes you do, but you do not often, so often hear success stories from Somalis. I mean, you hear them sometimes from Finland. I think in Finland, Somalis are very often well integrated. And I mean, some Somalis who have also the support, their families and so on, are partly well integrated. But at least in Germany, and also what I hear from the UK and partly from Italy, is that Somalis are very often having general problems over many years and do not really progress. However, as this quote by my colleague says, in Kenya, they are seen as almost too successful economically. So Somalis have this reputation of being very active business people. I mean, regardless of their educational background, the dream of many Somalis is just opening their own business, men and women. And they are very eager. They are very competitive. And I mean, it's a stereotype, but I mean, it's a stereotype. There's some truth to it, even in Eastern Africa, in Uganda, in Kenya. Also in South Africa, where quite a few Somalis migrated over the 2000s, Somalis had this reputation of taking, so to say, making business like with very small margins of gain, so to say. Somalis were extremely competitive, and this also, you know, made them suspicious or unwanted in places like South Africa, where there was xenophobic violence in 2007, 2008, I believe, where many Somalis were also targeted on small markets. And the same is also a little bit true for Somalis in Kenya, particularly in places like Nairobi, where Somalis kind of operate on very small margins and kick other competitors who are maybe Kenyan citizens out of the market with their little shops. And then if they're successful, they are building malls and, you know, they offer just cheaper goods. Maybe some of the goods are smuggled in from Somalia to Kenya, so they can offer very cheap electronic equipment, very cheap clothing. And so many established Kenyans, Kenyan middle class, also goes shopping, Christmas shopping to Somali malls in East Lee. So anyway, Somalis have quite a different reputation, let's say, in Kenya or in East Africa than they have in Europe. And of course, this is connected to the structural conditions in these different countries. I mean, in Europe, particularly in Germany, but I believe maybe also in Scandinavian countries, it's quite difficult to open a restaurant, to open a shop. So you have to fulfill lots of conditions in order to be open, to be able to open a little restaurant. In East Africa, that's much easier. And so you can start making your own money. And many Somalis actually dream of doing that. And this is now my last point. This is this reason for return. So, I mean, actually quite a few Somalis dream of returning to Eastern Africa as successful migrants. So they experienced, so to say, a status loss in Europe, particularly the first generation. I mean, those people who came in the early 1990s, who have been established in Somalia already, they had a professional life, they had a family. They came to Germany and they, or to Europe anyway, and they didn't have anything. They were just treated like black refugees from a kind of hunger country. So they of course, these people particularly dream of returning at least to Kenya, if not to Somalia, opening their own shops and, you know, having their own income and becoming successful. And quite a few of the older generation, men and women actually, are trying to live this kind of successful transnational life. And some succeed, even also older women, after they passed, to say, the children giving birth to children age. I mean, and when they're in their 50s, let's say, and they have some educational background, they often return to Somalia and to try to do their own business or become kind of advisors and work for NGOs and so on and so forth. And men are doing the same. So this would be kind of the voluntary return to Somalia of the older generation. And the dream is to become economically independent and to upgrade their personal status again from being a kind of a poor refugee to being somebody who has influence and respect in the Horn of Africa. This is desired by many people, and this life can be lived particularly by the older generation. The tragedy is that those younger people who are now since 10 years coming mostly to Europe, those people, first of all, they do not have the background in order to, you know, really build themselves up very quickly. And also conditions in Europe, I believe, have changed. So it's not very easy. They come without any documentation. They don't have any passports. They cannot simply return very quickly. They do not get citizenship very easily in many European countries. It takes many years if they can get citizenship at all. So they are running currently a real risk to become this kind of failed diaspora, I would say. So if they do not get a foot on the ground in Europe and start earning money and sending money back, they kind of consider the failure. The younger generation also, I mean, not just the recent arrivals, but also the children of the first generation, those people who are now in their teens or early 20s, they also run a risk of being a failed diaspora in the sense of, you know, going too much astray from moral, you know, violating the moral Somali code. And then there's this phenomenon of Dakan Ilis, which means return to culture. So it was once in the media, like a couple of years ago, it was really prominent in the media that Somali parents would bring their whatever 14, 15, 16 year old kids back to Somalia and just, you know, drop them there. You know, they would kind of lure them into the travel. They would say, you know, your uncle is marrying. We have all to travel to, let's say, northern Somalia, to Puntland, to Somaliland, or even to central Somalia. And then once the family arrives there, you know, the passports or the papers are taken away from the children, the parents leave, and the kids stay with some relatives back in Somalia, and they should get out of drug problems, of, you know, sexual engagements in London, or so in Helsinki or in Berlin or so. So this phenomenon of Dakan Ilis, this concerns mostly this 1.5th generation of diaspora, those younger kids of the first generation who grew up in Europe and then kind of went astray. And of course, the most recent generation of Somali migrants, let's say since 2011-12, they have often a very low, insecure legal status, so they fear deportation, and they would be considered, you know, a failure back in Somalia. So I don't know, you are all return advisors. So if you send a young man or young woman who arrived in Somalia in Europe from 2010 onwards, and she didn't make it, so to say, she didn't get a strong legal status, and she didn't get education and a job, let's say, in a European country, then you offer her some kind of money for return, but this kind of whatever you offer, $1,000 or $1,500, even $2,000, I mean, this doesn't really make a living, a very strong basis for a new beginning in Somalia. She or he will return to insecurity, and on top of that, she will be shamed as a failed migrant. Well, that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Presentation. I think we were all listening for, like, very intensely to what you said. So now the Q&A would be open towards the participants. Like my colleague was already saying, you can either use a hand sign and we will like switch a microphone on, and you can ask your question directly to be more active, but you can also use the chat box and we will forward your question. So once again, thanks a lot, Mr. Höhne.
Yeah, thank you so much. It was very interesting. You covered a lot of interesting points, also very interesting for return counselors. Thanks for that.
So maybe as we wait for the first questions, thanks also for sharing Belgium and Denmark, the situation in your European country. Maybe one question we already received in advance was one more time about the situation of single mothers. Ms. Höhne, you highlighted already that it's very difficult for young women having maybe kind of a different lifestyle. Could you maybe give some more details about the situation for single mothers who are not living with the father of the child, or maybe single mothers returning to Somalia?
Yeah, as I tried to outline when with this image of this one woman which I had there, I mean, very often some, I mean, the tradition, so to say, the traditional way of dealing with separation when you have children would be the mother, if the couple decides to separate, or the husband decides that he wants to divorce his wife, sometimes also the wife can push the husband into divorce if she wants to get rid of him. So in any case, if the parents split up, normally the young mother, let's say it's still a young mother, like maybe 25 years old with three children, she would simply hand over the children to the husband's family, because by clan, so to say, they belong anyway to the husband, so he's responsible for their well-being and also legally representing them. So typically he would hand over his children to his mother or to his to one of his sisters, and the mother would get out of this relationship as a single person, so to say, if you like. So now you can debate if this is the way to go. I mean, the experience on the ground is, and maybe some Somalis who are in this chat can speak about it. So the experience on the ground is that quite a few Somali women actually take this option. So they, particularly if they're still younger, they in a way drop the children with the husband and they become independent again, and they can remarry. If they are 25, 26, they remarry rather quickly very often, and they build a new family with a new husband. They establish the concept that a new husband would become the stepfather of the children from the first marriage. This is not common. I actually, in my whole 20 years concerned with Somalia, only met one family where there was, you know, or two families where actually there was kind of a stepfather involved. And I mean, it happens, of course, but it's not very common. So that's one thing. Of course, there are women who do not want to drop their children with the husband's family, particularly if the children are smaller, or if there's any kind of tension in between those families and so on and so forth, or the husband is not mentally fit, or his family has any kind of problems. So, of course, then she tries to keep her children, which puts her immediately in a very dire situation economically. I mean, there's no social support in Somalia whatsoever for unemployed people, for people who need healthcare, or even for single mothers with children. I mean, there's no social services in Somalia. The only social service you have is your own family. So if the family of the divorced woman with her children says, fine, we are helping you out and bring the children to us, or we are supporting you every month, or your brother from the United States sends you every month $200 so you can take care of the basic needs of your children and yourself, so then she's able to take this responsibility. But if she, for whatever reasons, she comes from a weak family background, or her family immediately, her close family has been already killed in the civil war, or she has overstepped some moral boundaries and she is kind of isolated by her own family, then she will get into very severe problems. I mean, how shall she survive in Somalia? I mean, she either has to go to an IDP camp in Somalia, or she has to go to a refugee camp in Ethiopia or Kenya, like this one woman I had on this image. That's actually her fate. She currently lives in a refugee camp in Ethiopia because she couldn't afford, you know, taking care of her own kids and herself. She would simply starve. So she's in a refugee camp right now. Or they have to go into prostitution, into clandestine prostitution, which is, of course, coming with many more problems. So, I mean, the life of single mothers in Somalia can be extremely challenging, and they must have very strong backing by their own core family, by their own patrilineal family, in order to make it. There was one more question, I think. It concerned, what was it? A mental health systems. Mental health care. I mean, this was just one question. Shall I talk about that?
We were just thinking maybe we combine the, there are two other questions about the risk you mentioned, a higher risk for returnees in the area like around Mogadishu if somebody's coming back from the diaspora. If you can give some more details on that and also about the situation for returnees who are returning to another area or city compared to where they originate from. We think maybe we would focus on that because also in the presentation on Tuesday, we talked already a little bit about the health system. So it will be included in the report. If we have still time, of course, we will go also to that question. But our focus, we would like to ask you to speak about the risk for returnees and another place.
So, okay, the risk of people returning to Somalia and then, so to say, not staying in the area where they kind of originate from. I mean, often there's this kind of this argument by authorities in Europe, then you can internally relocate. So if you, you know, your story was you're persecuted by Al-Shabaab in Mogadishu or surroundings, or you're a minority group member from southern Somalia, why don't you internally relocate? You can go to northern Somalia or you can go to central Somalia and you will be safe. Though this argument, so to say, can be refuted, if you like, because, I mean, even some people don't like to hear it, but Somalia is this kind of clan-based society. It was, in a way, re-clanized throughout the period of the civil war and the violence from 1990 onwards. So maybe in the 1970s and 80s, many particularly urban Somalis didn't care much about their clan belonging. They wouldn't really ask their neighbors if they are Hawiya or Darod or Isak or whatever. So this is very credible. I get many accounts from people who I met during my research who said, you know, until 1990, we didn't actually know much about our own clans or let alone the clans of our neighbors. However, this changed dramatically. And what is absolutely clear, if you look at, so to say, the political landscape of Somalia today, that people since 1991 sought refuge in the areas where traditionally their patrilineal relatives had a strong basis. So people fled, whatever, Darod, Dulbahante from Kismayo fled to Las Anod, to surroundings of Las Anod in northern Somalia. Even there have been urbanized people who have been well educated and so on and so forth. They fled to the countryside, to some kind of villages where the patrilineal relatives resided, and they established a new living there. What this means, and this goes for all the patrilineal groups in Somalia. So what it means today, if you travel across Somalia, you basically can say who belongs, I mean, with a high degree of security, who belongs to which kind of descent groups. Just when the person says, I'm residing in whatever, in Hargeisa, then you're 99% or let's say 90% Isak. If you reside in Garowe, you are almost 100% Machertain. If you reside in Baidoa, you are most likely Rahnwen, and so on and so forth. So which means internal relocation is not so easy, because if you're like from Mogadishu, like you are Hawiya from Mogadishu, or you are Asharaf from the surroundings of Mogadishu, from Afgoye, and somebody says, yeah, you can just go to Hargeisa or Bosaso in order to be safe, you know, you go, like, it's almost going to a foreign territory. So you will not be integrated in these areas. You don't have any relatives. And as I said now repeatedly, there's no social services. There's no authorities who say, okay, you're unemployed, you need support, you need housing, you need whatever, clean water, you need healthcare. You don't get it. So if you do not have a strong kinship network, any location is very often not feasible for people because they would go into territories where they're kind of aliens. And this is why many people in Somalia end up in IDP camps, because that's to say, you know, that's at least secures survival a little bit better than if I just take a private, you know, trip to Hargeisa. If I'm from Mogadishu and I'm not from a strong family background and I don't have any relatives in Hargeisa, I mean, nobody will take care of me. I will simply sleep in the streets and most likely starve. I mean, okay, so much about internal relocation. And then the situation of diaspora people generally coming back. I mean, there's a very nice report by a Norwegian think tank called PRIO about so to say, diaspora returnees. I mean, if you come back with citizenship, you have a whatever, you have a Norwegian passport, you have some kind of, you know, skills which you acquired over the last 15 to 20 years in Europe, you have some kind of economic capital, then you can return and you can be relatively safe and you can try to establish yourself even in Mogadishu. However, if you follow the news very carefully, I mean, there's regularly also, you know, high profile diaspora people are getting killed in Mogadishu. I mean, either they are targeted by Al-Shabaab directly, or they just fall victim to one of these bombings, which happens in those places where particularly also high-class diaspora people hang out. I mean, they would go to nice restaurants along the beach, and these restaurants are very often targeted by Al-Shabaab. So quite a few, so to say, successful diaspora returnees actually lost their lives in Mogadishu in the last 10 years, I would say. And nevertheless, I mean, many more actually made it. But this doesn't, you know, this applies to a certain group, you can almost say a certain class of Somali migrants in Europe. I mean, if you have a certain status, a certain age, a certain background, a certain different forms of capital, then you can make it in places like Mogadishu, and you can also, you know, buy your security and, you know, take care of these kind of things. And you can invest and make some a good living in Mogadishu or in Kismayo. However, if you do not belong to this kind of category of migrants, in Somali migrants in Europe, then you're returning to a place where you face lots of challenges. No, lots of security challenges. Even Al-Shabaab is nominally ousted from Mogadishu. It has a very strong clandestine presence. You know, it's not like Al-Shabaab has been kicked out of Mogadishu in 2011, 2012, and ever since the government or AMISOM control the city. But it's like every month Al-Shabaab operates in Mogadishu and you know, conducts bombings and threatens people. So, I mean, this is the reality of life in Mogadishu up until today. Yeah, so that's where you're returning to.
Okay. Thanks. Maybe we will talk afterwards if you can share with us the name of that report from the Norwegian organization, then we will include it into our report. I think that could be very interesting to get some more details.
Yeah. Okay. I think we still have time for one last question, I guess. We have a question here about the economic opportunities for returnees. Are there any, is there any assistance, any trainings, any schoolings for returnees so that they can start maybe a small scale business, or yeah, do you have any experiences in this field?
Yeah, maybe the speaker from the last webinar about return to Somalia had he was probably involved in some kind of initiative. I mean, I haven't come across I haven't come across these kind of initiatives for refugees, for returnees, on a larger scale. I mean, simply I didn't look for that. But you know, I heard many things over the years, and I really never heard about this kind of the significance of these kind of initiatives. And maybe these kind of initiatives, maybe by some kind of Somali NGOs, maybe also by some kind of institutions, like maybe the GIZ in Germany is supporting this kind of return from mostly Somali refugee camps in Kenya to Kismayo. I heard about that. But honestly, honestly, I believe that that these initiatives are nothing you can really rely upon, because that it's this economic boom, which is, some people say there's an economic boom taking place in Somalia. It was even reported, you know, by The Guardian in 2012, 2013. This economic boom as a term was included in the recent country guidance decisions by the Upper Tribunal in 2014, and it's kind of, you know, watershed case, a decision on Somalis in the UK. I mean, honestly, if you look at the more recent data coming from Somalia by institutions which like International Labour Organization, ILO, which kind of did more or less reliable surveys on the economic developments in Somalia, you don't see this economic boom. I mean, all the reports you can get from international institutions looking at employment in Somalia would say the unemployment is between whatever, 65 and 75% throughout Somalia. So, and my anecdotal ethnographic knowledge would say that, you know, people working as laborers, as porters in the harbor in Mogadishu or in Bosaso or in Berbera, they will be day laborers. They earn, if they are lucky, per day like 10 to maximum $15, and they don't get employment every day, though they survive with, you know, like 5 or 7 children and a wife from around $150 maximum per month. And this is pretty much the rate what you have for like manual labor, you know, manual, you know, people who are kind of masters, carpenters, whatever, you know, house builders. These jobs are extremely badly paid in Somalia, like all the craftsmanship, so to say, which is rather highly regarded in Europe, is blue collar jobs are not highly regarded in Somalia, and they're extremely low paid. So it's quite hard. Even if you get this integrative, you know, manual training, you know, vocational training stuff, and so what do you becoming? You become a sewer, you become a carpenter, and then what? I mean, you just don't starve to death in Somalia if you have this kind of, you know, specialties. So the people who are successfully returning and who profit from the economic boom, which is, you know, taking place in some parts of Somalia, even just some parts of Mogadishu, you know, people are profiting from this. This is mostly, let's say, the upper class, the high classes, who maybe, you know, the children have master degrees from a British university, and, you know, with 28 they return to Mogadishu and become the advisor of the prime minister. Yeah, then they probably earn like $3,000 plus whatever corruption every month, and they can afford a great life in Mogadishu, but that's not the reality of, you know, unskilled laborers back in Somalia.
Okay. Yeah.
So the economic boom has to be taken with a big grain of salt. So it's very selective, and who profits from it, that's the big question. And I would say ordinary people with limited, you know, manual labor skills do not profit really from this this economic boom. I mean, house construction, as I said, there's lots of house construction going on in Mogadishu, but, you know, the ordinary people in construction work, what do they earn? You know, they earn $150 per month max.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right, we have, as you can see in the chat, some compliments towards you for that excellent presentation. Regarding the time, we would still give a chance to two other questions. The questions are the question of Andreas and Juliet. We already we will refer them to the speaker from Tuesday and then give a response, because it's a very specific question about the family unification. And like I was mentioning, mental health, we already discussed a bit on Tuesday, and we will include more details in the report. So dear participants, feel free to use that chance for another two questions. First comes, first serves. So write down quickly. All right, we see already some people are using that opportunity.
Yeah, someone is typing.
All right. So the conclusion I would take, Mr. Winnie, from what you were just like mentioning about the vocational training, is, according to your opinion, vocational training can help a bit, but the problem will be that that kind of job will not be enough to earn one's living, right?
Yeah, particularly, yeah. I mean, this would be great actually for people in Somalia, you know, that, and I would always say vocational training is a super measure which should be supported in Somalia to prevent migration. You know, I don't understand why, you know, German governments pouring money in certain projects into Somalia, why do they not systematically invest in education, in job education in Somalia, preventing migration, you know, establishing, you know, and this means you shouldn't just give like a 6 weeks or maybe even 6 months course in whatever kind of sewing or brick building or something like that, but you should ideally establish a real course, you know, you should like give people a chance, you know, send some teachers, send some curricula for 2 years, and, you know, invest like into some kind of 5 years project, you know, building up some kind of you know, technical colleges or whatever, supporting the building up of technical colleges and plant, so to say, a seed, which then indicates to the local communities. I mean, there's lots of infrastructure needed. I mean, you need good electricians, you need good constructors, you need good, you know, roads. I mean, there's so little roads in Somalia, and they're in such a poor shape. I mean, it's amazing. You would have decades of work for many people if there would be the skills transferred and, so to say, as little support given. And of course, then also the image of these kind of jobs slowly but surely has to be lifted. And this is, as you can imagine, this is nothing you can do with a 2 years project. I mean, this would be something you can do in cooperation with the local authorities, and you know, and if people see, oh wow, the son of so and so became a construction worker and he has acquired skills and he's needed, and you know, he earns quite a bit, or he earns substantially, and people kind of respect him for that, then that you can change a little bit the societal outlook on these kind of blue collar jobs. For instance, drivers in Somalia have quite a bit of good reputation, you know, drivers like taxi drivers even, or overland drivers, which is something, a job which is not considered very highly in many European places. But in Somalia, to be a good driver, a skillful driver who knows the area and who knows to fix his car even under challenging circumstances, that's quite, you know, a recognized job, and you can have a good life being a driver. Yeah, you don't have a good life being a construction worker yet. But you know, if I were kind of a decision maker in Europe, I would kind of say, please, let's develop a systematic plan developing, you know, manual work in Somalia. But this is like a long-term project. This is not just like a small vocational training and then letting people off the hook, and you know, then they're just, you know, living a very poor life. And again, people returning from Europe who kind of came with quite different hopes and who invested lots of money in their journey and who went through a lot of traumatizing events on the way. I mean, you know, telling them, yeah, you can be a construction worker back in Somalia. I mean, that's almost a joke.
Great. Yeah. I hope it looks like this is going to be the final statement of the webinar. We have seen some people typing, but actually no question came through. So I think that, I mean, it's also a positive sign that people were satisfied with your presentation. That's perfect. All right. Now, still to be.
Oh, thank you. Okay.
Okay. So then we would like to say we are going to close that session. For the participants, we will send you an evaluation form, and we would be very happy if you can give us your feedback and maybe also some advice for improvement or for whatever you think makes sense for you. Yes, and I would say we are going to close our session. One more time, a special thanks to you, Mr. Hüner, as a very experienced speaker. I think, as you can see in the comments, it was very enriching to have you with us today, and hopefully we will maybe see you in person in another location if we have any other event of the Transnational Exchange Project. Definitely that would be something good.
Okay, thank you very much. It was fun. Have a good time. I just close it, and I guess I will be in contact with you by email, yeah?
Definitely. All right.
Okay.
So everybody have a great day, and thanks for joining us here.
Okay. Ciao.
Okay. Bye-bye.